Our first is data collection and analysis. BeaverCube shall collect data and determine when the iron cameras are directed towards Earth. That's mostly relevant to us because it's pointing direction. And for specifics on that, our second key requirement, ADCS shall provide passive pointing control with a maximum of 10 degrees error. The 10 degrees part comes from the camera's field of view, and also if it's tilted too much, then the picture will be really bad and kind of blurry, and it won't really be usable. Our third key requirement, BeaverCube shall record and downlink attitude data from its sensors every 90 minutes. So this allows us to keep tabs on its orientation and doubling and things like that. And our final key requirement, ADCS shall decouple to a speed not equal to its orbit period. If this were to happen, then the BeaverCube would be constantly positioned in a way where the camera would never face the Earth, and this would be really bad for the mission because the whole point is to use the camera. For our baseline design, here we have a CAD image of BeaverCube and some more specifics on our sensors. So first we're going to use our passive magnet to align the cube with the Earth's natural magnetic field. And we're also going to use hysteresis rods, which also use the magnetic field to provide a sort of dampening effect. And this will help the BeaverCube decouple. So it'll slowly stop, or at least slow down the spinning. And as for sensors, we have a thermopile mounted on the same side of the cube as the camera. So the thermopile detects IR light, and so it can kind of look for an area where it's as warm as the Earth, so it can sort of see where the Earth is. And we also have a magnetometer and a gyroscope sensor in the same chip. This is more of the orientation of the cube, which way it's pointing, and things like that. That's just within the satellite.
And so, to actually use a thermopile as a valid sensor, I had to do some calculation to get the output of the thermopile when it's pointing towards the Earth. The first value, 9 millimeter squared, is the area of the thermopile itself. So, and then the second value, 239 watts per meter squared, plus or minus. So I believe is the wattage per meter square of the Earth in IR, and then 110 volts per watt plus or minus 23 volts per watt is the sensitive reactivity of the thermopile. So using those values, we can see the range of value that the thermopile will give out when the thermopile is pointing toward the Earth. And then,
how about other objects like the moon or the sun?
It would not be warm enough to if it's the sun, then it will be too hot, and then the value will be way over the value that we got here. And then if it's the moon, I don't think it's warm enough, gonna reflect enough to give up this voltage. If it's the space, it will be just zero. Yeah, as you can see in the normalized output, in relation to the degree, the position of the Earth with regard to the sensor, it shows that there's only so much place that can give us those values. We give those values when the Earth is even in the field of view sensor, so we hope to use that to plus or minus 10 degree accuracy.
Okay, so taking a look at the software that's related to our system, this is the cutoffs, so all the phases in the mission, and as we go through, we have different steps. So BeaverCube is going to be off during pre-launch and launch, so we don't really have anything going on there. And just after deployment, we're going to start the detumbling process. since it's going to be launched in a kind of unpredictable way, we don't really know how fast it's going to be tumbling. But over time, the passive magnet and the hysteresis rods will slow that down and let it have like a stable orbit with less tumbling. And when it's stable enough to take steady-ish camera pictures, then we'll start the science mission. And during that, we'll use the turbofile to sense where the Earth is. And when it is pointed at the Earth, then the camera can take pictures at that point. And also during the science mission, we'll have telemetry, and we'll be able to send data from the gyroscope and the magnetometer back to the ground station, so we can monitor its orientation and general status.
So to know our orientation, we will use a gyroscope sensor, which will give out the Eurocube's spin rate, which will be important if we want to actually snap a photo that's not blurry. And then with the spin rate, we can also make predictions when the camera will face towards the Earth, and then we can send commands to take picture on a certain amount of time when the camera's pointing toward the Earth. These are some of the risks that we have with the ADCS, and the biggest risk is the rotation rate matching the orbital period of the satellite, which if it goes wrong, it's never going to be able to take a photo of the Earth, because the cameras will always be pointing away from Earth. And that risk is caused by another risk, which is hysteresis material not matching the manufacturer specification, which can slow the rate of detumbling or just cause what I just described before. And the others are magnet strength does not match the manufacturer specification, which can make the CubeSat wobble while it's in orbit. Thermal power failure will not allow us to sense the Earth as accurate as we would like it to be. And yeah, that's
it. So we have some ways of mitigating these risks. First of all, with thermopile failure, although it would decrease our ability to sense the Earth, we also have some backup systems in place, and we can use the gyroscope, sun sensor, and military tracking all together as a way to, as a backup system, basically. And for the hysteresis material not being as good as manufacturer specifications, we can test this ahead of time before launch. And this also kind of goes along with other hardware not meeting manufacturer specifications. We can test it, and we also have redundancy with other sensors and systems. So, degradation of ADCS components over time, we know that this is going to happen, and we can model this and predict it. And given that's a CubeSat, it's not going to have as long a mission as bigger NASA satellites, so we can account for this while scheduling out the mission and determining when it should end. And for that last risk, the rotation rate matching the orbital period, this is kind of one of our biggest, most dangerous risks. And for this, we can test and analyze hysteresis material extensively, and we can model